The Loyal Friend by A.A Chaudhuri, read by Nikki Patel for Saga Egmont.
Revenge proves its own executioner. John Ford, The Broken Heart. Prologue. There's a violence about the weather tonight, a kind of insanity that seems to accord with her own state of mind. The rain is brutal, lashing down with such ferocity, even turning up her wipers at full throttle had felt almost pointless. She's amazed to have made it back to her flat unscathed. She opens the door and steps into the pitch-black darkness, fumbling for the switch on the wall to the right, sighing with relief when the light comes on. She heads straight for the bathroom, ignoring her growling belly as she does so, taking her mobile phone with her, laying it on the bathroom stand. She turns on the shower and strips off her clothes, taking a second to admire her naked body in the mirror as it starts to steam up, before untying her long blonde tresses and stepping inside the cubicle. She closes her eyes and tilts her head up to the ceiling, enjoying the sensation of the water running over her, trying to blank out the last few days. The feeling that she is being hunted. She hears nothing but the sound of the powerful jets rebounding off the cubicle's tiled floor. Not the bathroom door opening, nor the footsteps approaching, nor a voice saying "filthy bitch" under its breath. But she does hear the cubicle door crashing open, her attacker repeating the same vile words, and with that, her fear is so great she cannot find her voice to try and save herself. No one will hear her, and very soon, she hears nothing at all. Chapter 1. The Present, Tuesday, 31st July, 2018. The woman pulls back the thick powder blue curtain a fraction and peers out of her bedroom window, sees the familiar black Vauxhall Astra pull up and come to a standstill. She waits with bated breath. No sign of its passengers just yet, causing her tension to rise, her mind to wonder what they might be talking about, why they are here. What they might have discovered since she last spoke to them only 3 days ago. Finally, the driver and passenger doors open, and she sees the detectives exit the car, serious expressions etched across their faces. Not unusual in their line of work, but there's something about their demeanour that worries her. A kind of singularly determined look that tells her they mean business, that they've made some kind of breakthrough. She watches them cross the road, eyes darting left and right as they do so, then approach the front door. Watches the more senior officer raise his right hand and press the bell. It's so quiet in her bedroom, the sound seems to reverberate around her in one thunderous echo. It's grey outside today. Chilly too, more like mid-autumn than late summer. She's even had to turn on the central heating. But it's the sound of her bell being pressed by her visitors that sends a shiver up her spine, rather than the cool temperature. She cannot dither a moment longer. Even though the last thing she wants is to go downstairs and open the door to her visitors. She leaves the bedroom, being sure to close the door behind her, then slowly makes her way down to the hallway, the sound of her breathing and the natural creaks of the building all that can be heard. Then she inhales deeply before opening the door to her callers. They're standing there with grave expressions, and when she asks them what's happened, how she can be of assistance, they say there's been a development in the case and inquire if they might come inside. She cannot refuse them. She must stay calm, act surprised, exude an air of innocence, be the best actress she possibly can. It shouldn't be hard. She's been doing that for so long now it's become second nature, donning another face for the world, hiding the truth, her past, the things she has done and kept secret from others. In any case, She's not the only guilty one here. Far from it. She latches onto that thought, flashes her most congenial smile, says, "Yes, of course, officers, anything to help." Then leads them inside and says a silent prayer that her secret is still safe. Chapter 2. Natalie. 11 days before. Friday, 20th July, 2018. I shiver as I trudge along the Thames path, heading for my yoga session at the River Club, where I belong. Last night's storm still making its presence known. Gone is the oppressive oven-like heat that's tortured us for the past fortnight, and in its place, an almost wintry breeze seems to cut through me like I'm some sort of ethereal being. Yesterday's storm has cooled things down markedly, and I'm thankful for it, having never been one for the heat. It's never sat kindly with my pale skin, nor my naturally anxious state of mind. Although at least now that I'm fitter, I can take it better. A stone lighter than this time last year, it doesn't sap all my energy, take the breath out of me like it used to. I have Jade to thank for that. It's not been an easy path, granted. In fact, it was bloody tough to start with, and I'd almost quit at the first hurdle. But she'd encouraged me, got me through the worst, helped me climb a mountain that at first had seemed insurmountable. Looking back, it's hard to believe I'm the same person I was before Jade walked into my life. As I stride along, making sure I keep to the right and don't cross over onto the cycle lane like I notice some thoughtless people do, I fish out my phone and check to see if Jade's messaged me back. I sent her several texts this afternoon, anxious to know why she's not replied to any of my calls or messages since Wednesday night's body attack class, checking she was okay. She'd looked so out of sorts that night, as if something was weighing heavily on her mind, and it had me worried. She didn't even stop to chat afterwards like we normally do, and that upset me. It made me think she's not over our row on Monday, even though we made things up on the phone the following afternoon and agreed to put it all behind us. To be honest, things have been a bit strained between us for a few weeks now, and it's set me on edge. Could well be the reason why my sleep's been so disturbed lately. Thursday morning, I woke up feeling like utter crap, and when I finally crawled out of bed, having only managed a couple of hours' kip, I ended up pulling a sickie, my usual morning routine thrown completely out of kilter. I'd felt so guilty, particularly as Jane's such a nice boss, but as I'm not in the habit of being sick, she was very understanding and said the library would manage without me for a day. Consequently, I spent most of Thursday afternoon slumped in front of the TV, but must have dropped off early evening as I woke up on the sofa around 3 a.m. on Friday, still in my sweater and joggers. Hungry and disorientated, the dregs of a cup of chamomile I seemed to remember drinking before nodding off, still on the table in front of me. I'd also neglected to tick off all the items on my day planner. For the third day in a row. That distressed me somewhat. It's vital I have confirmation that I've followed my routine, done everything I should have done. But at least I managed to put myself to bed afterwards and get some sleep. As I walk, I yawn widely. Hopefully tonight's yoga will help settle my mind and I'll sleep like a baby later. I don't function well without a good 8 hours. Sleep's always been a problem for me, and for a while I fixed it with pills like lorazepam. Until my therapist pointed out that these were causing me to experience vivid dreams and other unpleasant side effects, and were therefore not a long-term solution. She said following a routine, a good diet, avoiding caffeine and stress was the healthier, more sustainable option. I was tempted to leave the class just this once, but if I don't stick to my routine, it'll be so easy to fall back into old habits, and I can't chance that. Finally, I arrive at the club at dead on 6:15 p.m., like I always do, But as I race across the car park and approach the double doors leading to the main entrance, hoping to catch Jade before the class starts, I hear a voice call out my name from behind.
Natalie, is that you?
It is, isn't it?
Why the rush?
I stop dead in my tracks, feel my skin crawl. Susan. Her voice is unmistakable. A sort of low, raspy drawl that unsettles rather than comforts you. A voice that can't be trusted. Just because it always seems to have an angle to it. She knows damn well it's me. I mean, we see each other 3 times a week, almost without fail. Have done for the best part of a year. We know each other by the mere sight of our lycra-clad bottoms, for God's sake. Mine a sort of rounded peach, hers more of a sagging pear. We've been at coffee mornings and gym socials together, including Jade's 30th last month, a night when everyone got hammered. Except for me, who, as usual, remained stone-cold sober. We don't socialise because we enjoy each other's company, but by sheer circumstance, the club being our common denominator. We practically live at this place. For me, it's become a sort of home from home. I think it has for Susan, too, even though she'd never stoop so low as to admit it. She thinks she's too good for the likes of us, and that's why she enjoys playing her mind games, exuding a toffee-nosed air of superiority over me and others. That's the kind of person she is. No wonder her husband always looks so bloody miserable. I take a lungful of air and will myself not to be goaded by her condescension, even though there's a part of me simmering inside that wants to punch her lights out and wipe that infuriating smirk off her face. But I can't go there. That would never do. I turn around, give a false smile.
Oh, hi, Susan.
Yes, it's me. I just don't want to be late for the class. Need the loo first. Assume you're doing it? Just as I say this, a wave of tiredness overcomes me. My head hurts too. That kind of muzzy, vice-like fatigue that grates at your temples makes your eyelids heavy but at the same time flicker involuntarily. She rolls her eyes, glances at her watch. An Omega. I'm sure the other day it was a Rolex. The week before that, a Gucci. She drips designer like the King's Road. I instinctively fiddle with my Timex from Argos, feeling incredibly awkward.
There's 15 minutes to go, so you're well in time, she says.
Jade won't start without her number one fan anyway. Her eyes linger on me before she proceeds to examine her immaculate French manicured nails, making me feel conscious of my own bitten down ones, another smirk creeping across her face as she raises her head to meet my gaze once more. What did she have to say that for? I'm not some stalker. I'm Jade's friend. Maybe she's jealous because, unlike me, she has no real friends. And who would wonder, the way she goes on? It's pathetic, really. She's pathetic, even if she doesn't see it. Dressed in Nike purple and white leggings with a matching zip-up top. I notice she's also wearing pristine Asics trainers. Not that there was anything wrong with the pair of Reeboks she was wearing on Wednesday. Her dyed auburn hair is tied back in a low ponytail, but she's wearing less makeup than usual. I can't help wondering what's triggered this uncharacteristic lack of vanity. Usually, she arrives at Jade's classes made up to the max, her hair blow-dried like she's just stepped out of a L'Oreal ad, as if she's trying to make a point and feels the need to compete with the younger blood in the class, including Jade. Even though she doesn't stand a chance in that department, because Jade's young and fresh and way out of her league, and no matter how much makeup or how many expensive treatments she has, that's never going to change. Having said her piece, Susan gives me the once-over, like I often catch her doing, a kind of disparaging look as if she can't bear the sight of my cut-price leggings and T-shirt, then allows herself a self-satisfied chuckle. I notice the crow's feet around her eyes crease up as she does so, while her mouth seems crinklier around the corners too. Less foundation and concealer failing to cover the telltale signs of her smoking addiction. Despite her regular exercise classes and her protestations that she's a health freak, regularly starting her days with green smoothies and hot lemon tea, we all know she smokes like a chimney. You can't hide it, the acrid smell on her breath, a smell that infests a smoker's body like a malignant disease, no matter how many tabs of spearmint gum they chew on. My father was the same. Then again, he was a walking disease in himself, rotten to the core.
Well, run along then. We don't want to keep the boss waiting.
Susan stirs me from my thoughts, giving a gentle flick of her wrist like I'm an insignificant fly she's swatting away, her knuckle duster 4-carat diamond and platinum engagement ring glimmering in the early evening light as she does so. Once again, I swallow her superciliousness, force down the anger her tone stokes in me. The club is situated a little way back from the river path, bordering the quaint leafy village of Thames Ditton. As a premium member, I don't have to check in at reception. When I swipe my card at the turnstile, it automatically registers my attendance at tonight's class, and so I waste no time dawdling in the foyer waiting to be attended to by Karen on reception. I simply walk in, swipe my card, and immediately make my way towards the ladies at the end of the corridor. I always have a pee before my class. It's an unspoken ritual, I guess, even though I could probably hang on until the end. Having done my business, I'm out like a flash, sprinting up the stairs until I reach the second floor where Studio 2 is situated. A year ago, I'd never have opted for the stairs. I'd have taken the lift at any given chance because even a few stairs would have had me gasping for breath. It brings a smile to my face, makes me realise how far I've come, makes me think of my vile foster parents, Kath and Brian, and what they would have said seeing me like this. No longer the fat waste of space loser child they regularly made a point of telling me I was. They tried to starve me, like they did all the children. Couldn't understand why I didn't lose weight. Said I must have been genetically disposed to obesity, to being a freak of nature. They didn't know that my best friend in the whole wide world secretly gave me crisps and chocolate, which I stuffed my face with whenever I could. A crutch to make myself feel better. I reach the second floor, exit the fire doors and turn left towards the studio, but just as I do, I see several familiar faces striding towards me, including Susan and Grace. Grace is a regular too. She joined the club at the same time as me. I notice she has a somewhat vexed look on her face, although that's not exactly unusual. She has a lot on her plate and invariably arrives looking rather harassed. But just now she appears more troubled than usual. Vivian and Shelley are there too, plus Jill and Callie, with Bruce, the token guy in the class, lagging behind, as well as a few others who come to Jade's classes on and off but aren't regulars like us. A few of them motor right past me, not making eye contact, a kind of pissed-off vibe emanating from them. Why are they coming this way? Why aren't they standing outside the studio waiting to be let in? Looking at their expressions, I suddenly get a bad feeling. Something's wrong with Jade. I can feel it in my bones. And I'm sensing it's the reason she's not responded to any of my calls or texts. Just as I'm thinking this, I happen to look up and catch Susan's eye.
"Class is off,"
she announces. She almost sounds glad, triumphant about the fact. Disappointment floods my insides. Maybe Jade had a row with a guy she's been seeing. He's nothing but trouble, but she thinks he's God's gift. Doesn't see the reality of the situation like I do. Or perhaps it's not man trouble. Perhaps she's sick? She has looked a bit peaky of late. Why? I ask. My gaze automatically falls on Grace, just because I see her as being the more approachable of the bunch, even though she can be a bit vague at times. She gives me a sympathetic glance, hesitates a second, then opens her mouth as if on the verge of responding, but before she can utter a word, Susan answers for her.
Jade didn't show.
She says this particularly loudly and somewhat derisively, as if she wants to make the point that Jade's bailed on us all. In light of current circumstances, i.e. the fact that Jade's nowhere to be seen, I shouldn't be surprised by this revelation. Even so, I find myself saying, "What? Why? Are you sure?" Susan scowls. "Course I'm sure." She looks around her.
"You can't see her, can you?"
She shrugs her shoulders. And no, I haven't a clue why. How the hell would I know? It's not a big deal. So, our instructor didn't turn up. Why are you getting so worked up about it? Talk about defensive. It's not an unreasonable question to ask. I hear Dr. Jenkins' voice inside my head telling me everything's fine, that I need to stay calm, that I cannot afford any trigger points.
I thought Martin might have explained why,
I say. Passed on a message from Jade or something. I mean, he is the gym and class coordinator. We've been going to her classes for a year now, and she's never just not showed up. It's not like her. I wonder to myself if any of them noticed Jade looking out of sorts on Wednesday night, like I did. Maybe not. They don't know I've tried calling her, like, a million times since, that she hasn't responded to me once, not even by text. My gaze flits from one face to the other, but all I get back in return are the same blank expressions. Susan shrugs her shoulders again.
From the look on Martin's face and the little he said, I think he's as much in the dark as we are. He seemed quite pissed off, actually. Can't say I blame him. Even if she's got herself in some sort of trouble, the least she could have done was call to say she can't make it. It's bloody inconsiderate of her to let us down like this without any kind of explanation.
Trouble? I frown.
Why would you think she's in trouble? What is this?
Susan snaps back.
The Spanish bloody Inquisition. Look, I know you worship the ground Jade walks on.
I feel myself redden at this comment.
But let me enlighten you. She's no angel.
Like all of us, she has a life outside of this place, and I bet she has secrets even you don't know about. Everyone has. She pauses, her eyes narrowing. I'm sure even you do. I instinctively flinch, feel a sudden tightness in my chest.
Point is,
Susan carries on more lightly, her gaze switching to the others as if seeking their endorsement.
It's pretty clear Martin couldn't give any insight on the matter, but it's bloody slack, as I said. They could have got a tenpin if she'd given them more warning.
Martin, bless him, was very apologetic, said we could have a drink on the house. But that's all well and good. What a waste of my precious time. I could have been watching Real Housewives with a glass of Shiraz at this very moment. I deserve it after 3 days on the typo diet.
Christ, not another bloody fad diet.
I bet secretly she stuffs her face with Walker's crisps and dairy milk at night. She must do, else she'd be stick thin, which she most certainly isn't. I think about her comment about Martin being pissed off. All the women fancy him, except me and Jade. She told me so, which surprised me. I mean, he's handsome, fit, knows he's both of these, the way good-looking people do, but still has a certain unassuming charm about him. In essence, He's the male counterpart of Jade, which is why I always saw them as the perfect match. Plus, I've seen the way he looks at her. It's obvious he likes her. And it makes me wonder if he resents the fact that his feelings aren't reciprocated. I'm a bit cross too, I have to admit, Grace says with a sigh, running her fingers through her unruly fringe, the lines on her brow which, unlike Susan's, actually moves, creasing. She looks dog-tired, like she has all the cares of the world on her shoulders. I was so looking forward to tonight's class. I had such a shitty day. Mum's dementia seems to be getting worse. I spent most of the day at the home trying to convince her it was daytime and that she needed to change out of her nightclothes. She was about to go to bed when I arrived at 10 a.m. The nurses have given up, say it's normal, that they can't do anything about it and we need to let nature take its course. But I can't stand seeing her like that. I'm just glad Dad's not around to see it. It would have broken his heart. I never take the kids. It's too upsetting for them, even though Jim says they need to spend time with their grandma. I know I need to be tougher, more practical about things, but I can't bear for them to remember her like that. Grace receives sympathetic glances all round. She has it tough. Unlike Susan, who, as far as I can tell, worries about nothing and nobody but herself. At this moment, she's pretending to look concerned about Grace, her head cocked to one side, every now and again nodding as if she knows exactly what Grace is going through. But really, I bet her mind is still focused on missing Real Housewives, or perhaps whether she should get her toes painted rose pink or fuchsia pink at her fortnightly pedicure tomorrow. I could really have done with a session to de-stress, Grace goes on. Jim's locked upstairs in his study all day, so he's not much company. I feel like I'm going crazy sometimes, not talking to anyone. Before I know it, the kids will be grown and gone, and it'll just be me roaming the house talking to four walls. Oh, but you and Jim will have more time for one another then, Jill says. I was so worried when the kids went off to university, and I think Bill was too, although he'd never admit it. For years, our conversations, everything we did, really, had revolved around the kids, and with both our parents being up north, we never did date nights or weekends away. But we surprised ourselves, got to know each other again. The last 20 years have been like a second honeymoon. Next week, we're off on our third cruise of the year. Jill gives Grace an encouraging smile, who responds with a weak smile of her own. Her eyes still with that faraway look in them. And is that a tear I spot? Thanks. I hope you're right. I know I'm right, Jill says. Look at me. I'm 65 and I have more energy now than I did when I was your age. My 40s were the most stressful years of my life. That's what kids and elderly parents, along with trying to maintain a career, do to you. I thought I was on the verge of a nervous breakdown at one point. Anyway, Susan says, her tone ringing of boredom, who fancies a drink in the bar? Especially as the first round's free, thanks to Jade's no-show. I suggest the £8 a glass Chablis. I think I need one just to quash my irritation at having driven all this way here for nothing. Any excuse. Besides, she's only a 20-minute drive away. I glance at the others, who look equally put out. And as I do, a familiar rage hurtles through me. I mean, I can understand Grace being upset. She's got a lot to cope with. But I had expected the rest of them to show a bit more concern for Jade's well-being. But all they can worry about is their own inconvenience. Yes, it's disappointing not being able to have our session after we've all made the effort to get here. But it's not life-shattering. It's not world famine or anything. I know for a fact that Jade loves working here, so whatever caused her not to show up can't be good. As I think on this, my heart plummets to my stomach, an almighty lump developing in my throat, thinking about all the grim possibilities. The worry must show on my face because I catch Susan eyeing me suspiciously.
Are you all right? You've got a weird expression on your face.
I feel a familiar trembling coming on, and so I clench my fist again, will myself to keep control of my emotions, just as Dr. Jenkins encourages me to. The way my child psychologist would instruct me to after what happened and the trembling started. There might be a harmless explanation. I can't think the worst before I know for sure what's happened. I need to take things one step at a time and not get ahead of myself. But Susan's next remark doesn't help matters. I'm surprised she didn't let you know she wasn't coming. I got the impression you two were close. Best friends, even.
Do you know anything we don't? Jade must have said something to you, surely.
She pauses, then adds, unless you've had some kind of falling out? Fuck. I wonder, did Susan hear me and Jade argue on Monday? Or was that a lucky guess? All eyes are on me, and I suddenly can't breathe. It's always a bit stuffy up here. It's why the aircon in the studio is such a heavenly contrast. But I'm sweating now. Why the hell would I have been rushing to get to the class if I knew she wasn't going to show up? What a stupid question to ask. Don't get angry.
It's come as much of a surprise to me as it clearly did to you.
I pause, then say boldly, turning the tables, looking at each woman in turn.
That is, I'm assuming it did come as a surprise to all of you?
Silence, and I wonder what that tells me. Nothing, perhaps. Maybe they just feel sheepish for bad-mouthing Jade without knowing the facts behind her no-show. But then Vivian, who's American, pipes up. She married a high-flying investment banker donkeys years ago and settled here in the UK.
Sure surprised me,
Vivian says in her trademark Texan twang. Jade seemed fan and dandy on Wednesday. She chews on a piece of gum, a ploy designed to curb her appetite, and which perhaps accounts for her rake-thin physique, while twiddling one of her large gold-hooped earrings just about visible under the mountain of bleached blonde hair. As it happens, I was in touch with a friend earlier who does Thursday classes, and she mentioned Jade covered Shona's Zumba class last night. Said Jade was as perky as a peach, made it really fun. Which makes it even more of a worry, I think to myself. What on earth could have happened in the last 20 hours? Whatever it is must explain why she hasn't responded to my latest texts. It's so annoying, Callie says. My first night off the maternity ward in 3 days and no class. She rolls her eyes. I've done nothing but snack on crap from the vending machine these past few nights, and I can feel it round here big time. She pinches her sides for emphasis.
Smoking will cure that, Susan says dryly.
Works a treat for me when I need to shed a few pounds. Obviously, I don't make it a regular habit. Liar. Just then, Grace seems to mutter something, but I can't quite catch what she says.
What was that, Grace? I ask.
Everyone looks her way, her eyes wearing the same fretful expression, her mouth twitchy as she bites her bottom lip, then replies,
Oh, nothing. Just that I feel bad for moaning, as disappointed as I am not to have had the class.
I mean, I'm sure Jade wouldn't have failed to show up without a word to anyone, without having a good reason.
Finally, someone who shows a little compassion.
Susan lets out an exaggerated sigh.
Yes, perhaps. But she's always struck me as the flighty, self-centred type. Maybe she got a better offer, like a hot shag.
She's an incorrigible flirt. You must have noticed, despite her butter wouldn't melt demeanour. We can't get bogged down with it, though. She's only an instructor, after all. They'll get someone new in for next week if she's a goner. A goner? I so want to ignore Susan's insensitive comment, tell myself I have better things to do with my time than get into some petty slanging match with her. But I can't stop myself on this occasion. How can you say that? We all went to her 30th. You were practically attached to Jade at one point that night, pouring your heart and soul out to her, from what I saw. Susan widens her eyes. I didn't know I was being watched. I catch Grace's eye. She knows. She was there at the time, and stand my ground, even though once again Susan's managed to portray me as some kind of stalker. I was plastered, she says. I would have attached myself to a postbox if it had happened to be standing next to me. And besides, I attend most of the social events here. I'm a sociable person, and I like to put money into this place. She casts her gaze around. God knows it could do with a major refurbishment. If it's so bad, why the hell do you come here? I want to scream. Maybe it's because here she doesn't have to compete with clones of herself. This time, I do ignore her. Turn my attention to Grace. Did Martin mention if he's tried calling her? No, he didn't say much, like Susan said. I should imagine he has, though. I mean, it'd be the first thing you'd do, right? She looks around and receives several nods. Poor guy. He seemed a bit snowed under. Apparently there's a private function on later this evening from 8:30, and he's stuck here till late manning it. People have better things to do with their time than go chasing after unreliable gym instructors, Susan says. Again, I ignore her. I'm better off finding Martin, just in case he's had any joy reaching Jade in the last 10 minutes. If not, I'll try her mobile again, and if that proves unfruitful, I'll go over to her place. We're friends, and she wouldn't just ignore my messages, even though on Monday we both said some things we shouldn't have in the heat of the moment. She knows I was only looking out for her. All I wanted was for her to realise she's worth more than she gives herself credit for, that she doesn't have to let her past dictate her future. Chapter 3. Jade. Before. I've finally met the man of my dreams, the man I've been picturing since I was a little girl, the one who will make me whole, make up for my shitty past. He's everything I'd hoped he would be. Kind, caring, attentive. We had the most magical day yesterday. He said I'm what's been missing from his life all these years, then pulled me tight to his chest and hugged me so hard it almost made me cry. It was as if he couldn't bear to let go, as if I had become his everything, who he'd cherish for all eternity. I see how sad he is, though, behind the armour he wears. I know he wishes he could turn back time and do it all again, thinks about how his life could have been so different had he not tied himself to her. I assured him we can all say that, look back and wish we'd made different choices, else we'd be living perfect lives. Okay, so he's made some pretty crap decisions, been too trusting, gullible even, not to mention lived much of his life treading on eggshells where she's concerned, just because he's too afraid of what she might do. But then again, I've also been naive, let myself be walked all over. But as the saying goes, what doesn't kill us makes us stronger. It's never too late for second chances. And now he and I are being offered a second stab at happiness with each other. I told him he needed to grab life by the horns before it passed him by. no matter how guilty she makes him feel. She's been in the driver's seat for so long now, it's as if he's resigned to it, bullied into submission. But I told him he needed to wake up, that this is his time, our time, and that he shouldn't feel guilty about seizing his chance to escape. That I'm a big girl who knows what she's doing and that he can trust me. He'd smiled at me when I said all this, removed his snug red woolen scarf and wrapped it around me as we'd sat on a bench in the frosty morning air. I just hope my words were enough and that he stays true to his own. I'm not sure I'm strong enough to be let down again, despite the danger we might be placing ourselves in. He has become my world, the light in my darkness, and there is no way forward without him. Chapter 4. Natalie. Friday, 20th July, 2018. I leave the others, turn on my heel and make for the stairwell, hearing Susan mutter something under her breath. I'm sure it's something derogatory, but I don't care. I have better things to think about. I scurry down the stairs to the first floor, making sure I take the left-hand side, intending to stop off at the gym, where I know Martin can often be found, either supervising or giving a PT session. I exit at the doors, turn left, and walk along the corridor until I reach the entrance to the gym. I peer through the glass and try my best to spot Martin, but craning my neck this way and that, I see no sign of him. I go inside just in case I missed him, ask around, but to no avail. I'm disappointed, but decide to try downstairs. If he's staying late for a function, he must be around somewhere. Heading back towards the stairwell, I fish out my phone just in case Jade's texted. But she hasn't. I try her number again, but she doesn't pick up. I feel almost sick at the thought of what might have happened to her. I just have this sixth sense that she's in trouble. I reach the ground floor and head for the bar. It's still quite early, at just on 6:50, soft music playing in the background, but I spot a few regulars having a drink, some of them perched on stools at the counter, others, including Grace, Vivian and Susan, sitting at tables. They're tucked away in a corner, three large glasses of white wine in front of them. They certainly didn't waste much time getting their freebies in. It makes me doubt the sincerity of their supposed disappointment at the class being off. I'm also more than a little surprised that Grace took Susan up on her offer. I'd have expected her to rush off home. Having said that, she did seem particularly worked up this evening. Clearly, she needed the drink to unwind with no yoga on offer. Still, seeing them cozied up together, like some sort of conspiratorial clique, stirs something inside me. Frustration? Anger? Jealousy? I'm not exactly sure what it is, but I do know I resent them for being so blasé about Jade's non-appearance. Grace happens to glance up and catch my eye, something of a sheepish look in hers. I have no choice but to go over, courting a disdainful glare from Susan as I do. Any luck? Grace asks, following this up with a hopeful smile. I shake my head. No sign of Martin in the gym, and I can see he's not here, so I'll go and ask at reception on my way out. Grace picks up her glass, takes a sip, her eyes locked on mine over the rim. Maybe he's in the function room? Yes. Maybe. I nod. Can't tempt you with a drink. Susan's tone smacks of insincerity. I'm not a fool. I know I'm the last person she'd want to have a drink with if she could help it, so why does she bother asking? It's like she enjoys making me feel uncomfortable. She also knows I'm teetotal, the least fun drinking partner she could wish for. I shake my head. Say with a sharpness to my voice, funnily enough, I'm not in the mood. She doesn't bat an eyelid.
You would be if you actually drank alcohol.
Exercise is all well and good, but there's nothing better than a shot of vodka hitting your bloodstream.
She holds up her glass. Or a silky smooth chablis. I watch her take a protracted sip. Watch her swallow it down her stringy, sun-damaged turkey neck, and at the same time, can't help wishing she'd choke on it.
Mmm. Tastes like nectar.
That's where you go wrong, Natalie.
Right now, you're more wound up than the Duracell bunny.
If Jade's in trouble or she's done something wrong, they're not going to tell any of us. So, if you want my advice, I'd just leave it be.
Her advice is the last thing I'd take.
That's the second time you've mentioned Jade having done something wrong. Why would you suppose that's the case? Why aren't you more bothered about the fact that she could be hurt or ill?
I let my gaze drill through her, delight in watching her eyes flicker with apprehension. Even so, she's quick to regain her composure with a firm shake of her head before throwing back more wine.
I'm not supposing anything. Look, just forget what I said. I meant nothing by it. What I'm trying to say is, if it's personal, they're not likely to tell you. It would be a breach of confidentiality.
It's true, honey, Vivian chimes in.
Come and have a drink with us.
Even if it's only a Coke, my treat.
She grins, revealing a perfect set of gleaming white teeth. It's hard to know which bit of her is real and which is fake. She clearly doesn't know me very well either. Coke is a complete no-no for me. I politely decline, say my goodbyes and practically sprint out of the bar, almost colliding with Martin, or rather his torso, in the process.
Oh, sorry, Martin!
I gasp. I wasn't looking where I was going. He's not in his sports gear today. Instead, he's wearing the club's branded navy blue polo top and grey trousers, his dark blonde hair parted at the side. Perhaps he's been in a meeting or busy getting the function room ready. There's no question how handsome he is. I've even caught Grace glancing his way, blushing like a teenager with the biggest crush when he happens to walk by and say hi. Tall, broad-shouldered, I know from what Jade said that he's a hit with most of the female staff as well as the clientele. Martin would have been a much better choice for Jade than him. But she told me he's too young, that she needs someone older, more mature.
That's okay. I can't apologise enough for there being no class tonight. So disappointing, I know.
He looks genuinely sorry. Can't think what came over Jade. Have to say, I'm not best pleased, and neither is my manager.
I take it you haven't been able to speak to her then.
To be honest, I'm more worried about her than there being no class. She's not picking up any of my calls or messages. I just hope she's not hurt or in trouble. I fix my gaze on Martin, but it's hard to read his expression. I can't tell whether he knows something more than he's letting on.
I'm sorry, Natalie. I know you two are close, but I've not spoken to Jade. No one can get through to her.
Oh. I've tried calling, left voicemails, as has Karen. His tone becomes sharper.
Frankly, I'm pretty ticked off. The very least she could have done was pick up the phone. It doesn't look good for the club's reputation, our instructors not bothering to show up without a word of explanation.
Yes, but it's unlike her, I say in Jade's defence. She's never done anything like this before, has she? Let you down, I mean?
No, Martin shakes his head.
She hasn't, that's true. Usually she's very reliable.
What if she's had a car accident?
I don't think so. I checked the local travel updates and there've been no reported incidents in the area.
Is it me? Or is he really not that bothered? Or am I just taking out my frustration on Martin?
I would go over to hers myself, see what's what, but there's a function on here tonight and I have to be around. I give him a nod. That's okay, don't worry. I'll go over and check on her. I was going to anyway. Martin thanks me, and I agree to let him know if I manage to get to the bottom of Jade's absence. It's gone 7:30 p.m. by the time I leave the club, heading back along the Portsmouth Road towards Surbiton, where Jade rents a flat on the second floor of a converted period building on one of the many tree-lined avenues branching off the main high street that's dotted with charity shops, pubs, cafes, and convenience stores. She gave me a set of keys around 8 months ago when she'd asked me to look in on her place while she was away on a two-night training course. I'm only a 5-minute walk away, she said, so it made sense. I'd offered to give them back, but she'd insisted I keep them, just because I'd become such a close friend and she trusted me to keep them safe. It touched my heart that she felt she could count on me like that, so much so I had a duplicate set of keys to my place made up for her. I didn't tell Dr. Jenkins, though. I didn't think she'd approve. She knows what I'm like. That letting someone into my personal space is a big deal, a big risk for me. For so long, I've been precious about my stuff, always needing everything just so. So I can't exactly blame her, but it felt right somehow. I felt that Jade and I had struck up enough of a bond for me to let her into my home. And it was a good feeling, being able to trust again after being let down by so many people in my life. After losing the person I counted on the most. Jade's keys are attached to my own house keys, so there's no chance of me losing them. It's summer and still light, although not as bright as we've been used to in recent weeks, now that the temperature's cooled and the days have been cloudier. At least the wind from earlier has died down, losing that piercing chill. I'm nearly at the bottom of her road, having turned off the river path some 5 minutes ago and taken a street leading up towards the centre of town, passing my own house along the way. I check my phone again just in case she's messaged, but it's wishful thinking. I try calling once more, then, when I get no joy, send a text. Hi, you okay? But there's still not a peep from her. Finally, I reach her building. Standing there, I glance to my right and notice her car is parked a little way up on the other side of the road. That's a good sign, surely? She must be in. But if that's the case, why hasn't she responded to any of my calls, or Martin's? I stand there for a few seconds, looking up towards her window on the second floor, hoping to God she's in. Hoping to God she's safe. Hoping to God I won't live to regret the day Jade walked into my life and I allowed her to throw it off track. Chapter 5. Natalie. 1 year before. July 2017. My alarm clock's shrill ringtone wakes me with a start at 7 a.m. The same hour it goes off every morning without fail. Weekends too. I'd probably set it to the same time if I ever were to go away on holiday, but that's never going to happen because I've got no one to go on holiday with. I try not to dwell on this. At any rate, it's my choice to be alone. My life is better for it, while a change of scene would rattle me, and that wouldn't do. Wouldn't be relaxing at all. I'm a creature of habit. I like things just so. I have done ever since I left foster care, went through college, got a job and a place of my own. Everything in my home has its set place. It pacifies me, suits my character, makes me feel safe, in control. The exact opposite to how I felt growing up as a child and which caused all the bad stuff to happen. I live in a two-bedroom cottage house in Surbiton, just off the Portsmouth Road, which runs parallel to the Thames Path. It's small, but it has the advantage of a decent basement, where I have enough tinned food and water stocked to feed an army in the event of some major national crisis. Unlikely, I know, and I hope and pray it never happens because I loathe basements. But you can never be too sure, and being prepared is everything. I love being by the water. It keeps me calm, centres my mind, and it's so freeing being able to walk to and from work along the river road every day. Also, as has been the case with everything in my life since leaving foster care, it gives me routine. My therapists have always said that's so important for me, having routine, feeling settled, not putting myself in any kind of threatening or stressful situation. After rising, I immediately shower for 15 minutes. I set an alarm for this too, just because I don't want to go over the allotted time. That would really derail my morning, and I can't have that. I have fine shoulder-length brown hair, so it doesn't take me long to wash and towel dry it. I can never be bothered with hair dryers, let alone fancy preening items like tongs or straighteners. I'm not fussed by that sort of thing. It would be self-indulgent of me, and besides, I've never been a looker, so it probably wouldn't do much good. I cut the ends myself, because I can't face setting foot inside a hairdresser. I can only imagine the looks I'd get were I ever to do so. I'd die of humiliation, and I wouldn't begin to know what to ask for. And the stress of not knowing would probably send my blood pressure through the roof. It's not like I'm searching for love or have anyone to impress. I have Ernie, my goldfish, for company. Ernie is the perfect companion. He knows his place and never does anything to wind me up or hurt me. I love watching him glide through the water. Whenever I do, I feel my underlying stress ebb away, a sense of peace descending over me. Other than Ernie, I am content to be alone. Being with someone scares me. It would cause too much disruption to my ordered lifestyle, and I can't take that chance. While the very idea of being intimate with a man terrifies me. After showering, I brush my teeth for exactly 2.5 minutes using an electric toothbrush, then get dressed in my high-neck blouse and ankle-length skirt, put on my glasses and pad to the kitchen, fill the kettle and boil some water for my first cup of decaffeinated tea of the day. I'll have 3 more at Kingston Library, where I work as a full-time library assistant. No more, no less. I don't bother with much makeup, just a neutral lipstick and lick of mascara. Foundation is too much of a faff. My decaf tea is taken with a splash of milk, no sugar. Sugar would only raise my anxiety levels, as would caffeine. I also pop 2 slices of square wholemeal bread in the toaster and fish out the low-salt margarine from the fridge in preparation. While I wait for the water to boil and my toast to pop, I go to my day planner and tick off shower, teeth, dress for the appropriate day, then slide the marker pen back into its slot above the whiteboard. Every night, when every item on my checklist is complete, I will wipe this clean, write a new date, and plan in preparation for the next morning. That way I'll know exactly what I've done and where I've been. A few minutes later, I'm sitting in front of the TV in my tiny living room, watching BBC Breakfast. I don't have a lot of furniture, just a beige fabric 2-seater sofa, a small coffee table, and a 28-inch TV, along with Ernie in the corner and a potted plant. Too much stuff would overpower me. Things must be clean, visible, and tidy. It's hot and stuffy in my flat, not surprising as we're in the throes of a heat wave, but I'm too scared to leave the windows open overnight in case of intruders. There've been a spate of burglaries in the area in recent weeks, and the idea of someone breaking in and going through my stuff terrifies me, even though I don't have much of value. Just my laptop, the odd item of jewellery, and some petty cash I keep in a jar in the kitchen. I can literally feel every inch of my fair-skinned body expanding, sweat accumulating between the rolls of fat around my waist and sliding up my back as I sit, blowing, then sipping my tea. You'd think with my relatively healthy lifestyle, I'd be stick thin, but the fact is I eat too many carbs. Bread and pasta are my biggest weaknesses, and that, coupled with not much exercise, isn't a good combination. The tea only makes things worse, and so I only drink half, toss the rest in the sink, load the dishwasher, cross breakfast off my list, gather my things and leave the flat, making sure to double lock it before I do. You'd think it would be a relief to get outside, but it's almost as suffocating in the open air as in my flat. I cross the road to take the river path to the centre of Kingston. The air is still, no breeze at all. I pass several early morning runners, feeling seriously inadequate next to their toned physiques, jogging mothers pushing their babies in buggies, office workers like me heading towards their destinations but striding more purposefully, many of them having removed their suit jackets which are slung over their backs or draped across the crease of their elbows because of the heat. None of them appear as harassed or out of breath as I feel, though. I mean, I know I'm out of shape, but the heat only serves to accentuate this fact, and I find myself wheezing as I quicken my pace, conscious that I'm a little behind schedule. The idea of being late, even by a few minutes, disconcerts me, and so I'm aware that I need to make up for lost time. I shuffle along faster, growing hotter by the minute, feeling my ankles swell in my sensible court shoes, the sweat now dripping down my back and drenching my armpits, making me wish I'd brought a change of top. No doubt Sam, one of my colleagues at the library, a stuck-up sort who looks like she belongs behind the beauty counter at John Lewis with the amount of makeup she plasters on, will have something demeaning to say the moment she spies me. She normally does, even if it's just with her eyes. But I never say anything in response, despite wanting to. I'd love to answer her back, yell at her to piss off, but I know it would only lead to no good, and I tell myself she's not worth my time and energy. Finally, having made it to Kingston Town Centre and crossed two sets of traffic lights at the busy one-way system, soaked with perspiration and feeling like I'm about to pass out, I reach work and enter via a side door reserved for employees. The familiar smells of books and coffee greet me as I walk in, and all at once a sense of calm filters through me, knowing I'm in the one place that brings me peace. Books have been such a comfort to me since I was a child, offering an infinite number of worlds I could get lost in, but most importantly, a welcome escape from reality. Jane, my manager, is a coffee addict. It's only 8:45 a.m, but she'll be on her third mug already. All day, she flies around like a bee on speed. Small wonder, with the amount of caffeine she puts into her system, and I fear that one day she'll keel over from a heart attack or something. I never touch coffee, and I wonder how Jane possibly gets any sleep at night. She's a wiry woman in her late 40s, with short brown hair and spectacles permanently perched on the end of her nose. I know she has a husband, but no kids. I always wonder what happened there. She seems the maternal type, but I daren't ask, and besides, I don't need other people's complications in my life. She hears me approach, looks up immediately with her thyrotoxic eyes, and I catch the look of horror on her face. Evidently, I look a fright. I certainly feel like one. "Dear God, Natalie, are you okay? Your face is as red as a beetroot. Come and sit down, I'll fetch you some water." I let her steer me to a chair, say thank you, then wait for her to bring me a glass of water. She's back in a flash and instructs me to drink it all. I do as she says, and before long, my body temperature has cooled considerably, but I still feel exhausted. I'm so unfit. It's pretty sad, but the idea of exercising in itself is exhausting. "How's that? Feeling better?" Jane's eyes lock on me, full of concern. She's a kind person, calm too, despite her caffeine habit. The ideal boss for someone like me, and I tell her I'm grateful. But just then, Sam, who's never on time, flounces through the door and my mood instantly drops. She's wearing a strappy red summer dress with white wedges, her glossy chestnut tresses bouncing off her bare shoulders. Her gaze latches onto me, and I see scorn in her eyes in contrast to Jane's pity.
"What on earth?"
she begins. Jane explains how I'm feeling rather overheated. Sam dumps her Louis Vuitton bag, I'm sure it's fake, on the floor, pulls out a nail file and begins to work on her right thumbnail, which looks perfectly fine to me.
"Oh, you poor thing,"
she coos, pulling a sad face.
"Look, don't get me wrong, but I do worry you might have gone and brought this on yourself, Nats."
I hate it when she calls me Nats. Only Jack was allowed to call me that.
"I don't mean to sound harsh or anything."
"No, of course not."
"But there really is no excuse for slovenliness in this day and age. There's a leisure club a short distance from your house, isn't there?"
"Yes."
"If I were you, I'd join it. I work out 6 times a week. You don't get to look like this without putting the work in."
She flashes a pearly white smile and does a twirl, and I literally want to kill her. Plus, I'm sure she's had a few nips and tucks here and there.
"I don't like gyms," I reply meekly. I hear my voice, so docile, pathetic even, but I daren't be more belligerent. Don't let on that the merest thought of stepping inside a gym and exposing my unsightly bingo wings and love handles to a bunch of self-serving judgmental narcissists has me breaking out in a cold sweat. She rolls her eyes and shakes her head.
"Now, how would you know that, Nats? Have you ever been to one? Anyway, the River Club is more than a gym," she waffles on.
"It's a social club. There's tennis and a bar, and again, please don't take this the wrong way, but I'm guessing you could do with pepping up that area of your life.
I so hate to think of you being lonely. I mean, it's like you're middle-aged or something." Another sad face. I count to 5 inside my head. Take a deep breath. The answer to her question is no. I haven't ever been inside a gym, so I guess she has a point. But there's a reason for that. One of her is bad enough. The thought of mixing with a room full of Sams is my ultimate nightmare. I'd rather slit my wrists. As for being social, I can't think of anything worse than trying to make small talk with a load of strangers I have nothing whatsoever in common with. It would drive me mental. I'd rather talk to Ernie. He's no trouble. I can trust him. He doesn't talk back. I simply shake my head.
Now, Sam, don't get on to Natalie," Jane interjects.
"She's not into gyms. Not everyone is."
"Oh my goodness, is that the impression I gave? I really wasn't getting on to her, Jane."
Sam looks positively affronted that the thought should ever have crossed Jane's mind.
"I'm just trying to give Nats some gentle advice."
Yet another patronising look.
"Now's the time to start, when you're still relatively young. It'll catch up with you before you know it, and the damage will be irreversible. Anyway, I've tried my best out of the goodness of my heart to make you see sense. But now I have some cataloguing to do. See you later."
I watch Sam pirouette off and disappear through the double doors leading out onto the library floor and feel an immediate sense of relief. A quick glance at my watch confirms it's 15 minutes to opening. I tell myself that I'm okay, that I need to get a grip, get on with my work.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.